We are now joined by the beautiful Paul Dooley, the sexy Frank Conniff, and the
middle-aged.
Oh,
gorgeous.
Gorgeous. Cathy Ladman. Hi, Cathy.
Hi, David.
Sorry to keep you waiting tonight.
That's okay. This place is like, I had no idea what I was, what this was like, this whole endeavor.
It's a hornet's nest of writers and comedians. And
crazy.
Actors.
My husband just texted me and said, is this a podcast or are they rewriting Hamlet? And Frank said both.
We're punching up Hamlet.
Does he have to die at the end? Let's have it be more upbeat.
Can he be a little more decisive?
As long as you're talking about this, I want to mention something. My wife is the author of Wicked, one of the writers. She wrote the dialogue.
Oh,
the book.
Cool.
Winnie Holtzman.
Yes, I know. Yeah.
They're planning the Japanese version. They have meetings with Japanese people, with interpreters there. And it was so funny because you'd think Wizard of Oz is known throughout the world somehow, but it's not as much well-known in some countries as it is here, even though they know something about it, but it's not a big obsession like a lot of Americans. So the Japanese people are saying, why a girl have to be green? And they say, why, let me look at notes, munchkins must be small. Why little go throw water? So these questions were so funny because we know it so well. We think it's life.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Eventually they came around and we made them understand. They were made to see what the story was.
This is a terrible thing to say. That's why I'm going to say it. I would figure in Japan they'd say, why are the munchkins so tall? Of course, that's a...
The truth is, there's one munchkin in the whole story, and he's just a short, normal guy. There's no midgets, there's no dwarves, there's nothing. He's just one munchkin. I don't know how they get by with that in the Land of Oz, but...
Well, also...
The focus to be on the Green Girl and Glinda the Good Witch.
Well, in Japan, they changed the title to Dorothy versus Godzilla.
True enough.
I think this is a rich topic. It's the perfect storm of jokes. If I weren't tired right now, I could think of some about what would the Cowardly Ryan want?
That's the Irish word.
College.
It's funny, they sing it all in Japanese, and they come to one word, and they say, popular, because that's a key word in that
right,
song.
Right.
I want to see that show. I wanted to take my daughter, actually, to see it.
The production.
Well, if she's anywhere near adolescence, she'll adore it.
She's 8. Is she too young?
No, she's not too young.
Okay.
The production in L.A. is supposedly really great.
Kids who come to the show, they're sort of between, some of them 5 until about 16. They come back 3-4 times. I don't know how the parents can afford it.
Really?
But they insist and they come back. And it really touches people in adolescence who don't know who they are and who they're going to become. And they're anxious about they don't belong, and which is true of almost everybody.
Right.
Even once we become 40 or 50. But
yes.
They just identify with this green girl so much. She'd be like the only black person in a culture, the only Jew in a culture.
In a Jewish culture, she wouldn't be the only green. There would be plenty of greens. Also, the scarecrow would, if he was only good at math, that would be his. My brain is not working.
Here we go, David. I know you've been thinking about this the whole time, right?
It's like
what's the scarecrow going to? What is the scarecrow going to say?
It's like a popcorn
kernel. Well, the scarecrow
kernel.
Had invested in tin.
So, Cathy, the holidays are, as I think Robert Benchley once said, around our neck.
Oh, that's brilliant. Well, you know, I was raised Jewish.
Really?
My husband, yes.
I don't mean to interrupt you. The late, great, I'm sorry,
go ahead.
But
no,
I have not talked about Christopher Hitchens at all because it's too difficult for me to talk about Christopher.
Especially with a woman in the room, because he
no
thought
kidding.
They weren't funny.
That's right. He was really... Yeah, I mean, I was talking to Frank about this earlier. That always really was really hard for me, you know. That he wrote an article about why women aren't funny,
and it made no sense.
Yeah,
you know, I never read the whole thing.
It's why
curious.
Women couldn't be a CEO, and women couldn't fix the motor of a car, because it takes intelligence to do all these things.
Right.
It takes intelligence to invade a country. Based on lies, which is something he supported.
Right.
All a woman needs to be a comedian or a comedian is to be angry like all the other comics. It's a base of fury. You have something you want to...
Is that true, Cathy? Are you angry? You're very funny.
I am so angry, but I turn it on myself, like many comedians.
And that becomes depression and anxiety.
Yes.
Christopher Hitchens.
It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah. I have conflicted emotions about Christopher because I knew him. He used to come and be a guest on a show that I worked on. He used to come in every year, and I would sit at his feet. And this was in the 90s before he supported the war in Iraq.
Right.
I was in awe of him, and he was very generous with his time with me, and I'd ask him questions. And one of the things I said to him with a group of people, and I was very subservient to him, and I was about to make a statement, and I had a parenthetical. I said, now, I don't know if you know this, but I'm Jewish. And he goes, just stop for 1 second, please. Don't destroy the one shred of mystery that I have about you.
That's pretty funny.
That's
and
very funny.
I just fell off the... I mean, that was just such... It was so cutting and biting.
Well, I mean, he was brilliant. I mean, he had, like many brilliant people, he wasn't always popular. But, you know, it's very hard for me to fawn about him when he said something that it was so personally insulting to me.
So now the holidays are upon us, and you have a normal Jewish family, right?
No,
you have
a wife,
and I would assume you are celebrating the holidays just like any normal Jewish woman, correct?
Right. Oh, let me take my apron off. I am married to a
man. Jewish man?
No, I am married to a man from Minnesota who was raised... his religion is called Swedish Covenant. Well, I shouldn't say it's his religion. He was raised Swedish Covenant, which is some kind of, you know, that's one thing I don't understand about Christianity, because, you know, when you're a Jew, you're basically a Jew, but when you're Christian, there's like this myriad of sects.
It's up for grabs, isn't it?
I think it's sort of like when AT&T split into all those companies.
If only
they all give phone service.
Could be blocked.
The what?
If only their acquisitions could be blocked.
So Tom is from Minnesota.
So this would be like a Lutheran spinoff?
Yes, I think
like
it is.
Like Phyllis.
Right, exactly.
She was a Lutheran.
And she was in Minnesota.
Right.
And her husband was named Lars.
Joni loves Chachi. Yeah.
And then we have a little girl.
Well, so is
and he, she's Chinese.
Is Tom, is he religious? I would assume
no,
he's
not.
No, I get atheist off him. Or contempt for religion.
Definitely contempt for religion. I mean, he and I are...
Because I definitely got contempt for Jews from him, so I figured he's just contemptuous of all
That's
religions.
That's only in the past 2 years.
So you have a daughter who's part Protestant...
No, she's
one part Jewish.
She's not. We're not religious.
I'm trying to figure out what the joke is. She's part Asian and part Jewish.
Yeah. Well, basically, here's the joke. This is the joke that my when I was in New York, I was talking to my aunt, and my aunt said, "Are you going to raise your daughter to be Jewish?" And I said, "No, we're going to just raise her to be a good person." And my aunt said, "That's terrible."
How about she's part Jewish and part Chinese, which means she has a Chinese meal, and then 5 minutes later, she's hungry to complain about it again.
All right.
All right.
I was working on something.
Yeah. I'm
an hour later joke.
So, Milan.
Milan, yes.
M-I-L-A-N?
M-I-L-A-N.
And is that an Italian name?
No, it's not. It just so happens that it came out that way. But what we did is when we were... She's adopted, by the way. when we were getting ready to adopt her, we were trying to figure out a name. And
did you go to China?
Yes, we did go to China. Oh, everybody does.
They don't have takeout here in America?
I get
all these menus for kids on my front doorstep.
And you can believe it? And it wasn't fast also. It took a good couple of years. So we just chose syllables that sounded Asian, and then we put them together randomly, and liked Milan the best.
It does have a beautiful sound and a nice rhythm,
yeah.
You know. So. But the people in Milan will be surprised to know,
I know.
That it's not Italian.
She's eight.
And
when
eight.
You said she was adopted, I'm thinking, oh, no, I thought she came out in the delivery room. You said, oh, look, she's Chinese.
I know.
I had no idea.
All those Sunday nights really added up to something. And she, it's really funny because we have a menorah, and she really, we celebrate every holiday that comes down the pike, basically. And she started putting candles in the menorah last week, and then she put a candy cane in the menorah as well. She just likes everything, which I think is so great.
That's Reform Judaism, when you put the
candy cane
in the menorah.
As Woody Allen once said, he was a reform rabbi. Well, very reform. He was a Nazi.
Is she going to Hebrew school?
No, we're not religious, David.
Not religious at all.
Did your kids go to Hebrew school?
Yeah.
Okay.
I figured it's important for kids to have some religious background so that when they're in their teens, they can rebel against it. Did you go to religious school as a child, Paul?
There were no religious schools. I'm from West Virginia. There were no religious schools.
But they had church, right?
They had church. My parents were Baptists.
So did they go to church every Sunday?
They being my mother, yes. My father never went. I think she only went to see her sisters and her nieces and her cousins.
So it was more of a social thing.
Yeah. And at the end of it, they would go nearby to one of her sister's houses or one of the relatives, and they would schmooze all day. They didn't call it schmoozing. It wasn't about religion, really.
Right.
No, I was not very religious. I'm agnostic.
And Frank, your father used to blow up churches in Alabama.
He did. Which
he was against integration. You come from royalty.
Not that I recall.
You come from journalistic royalty.
Is a Pulitzer Prize winning journalist. He wrote for he worked for Hearst newspapers. He initially distinguished himself as a war correspondent in World War II, and when he came back, he had a column in the Journal American, which was a newspaper at the time. I was just talking to Paul about, and he traveled all over the world and interviewed all the world leaders and everything. So he led a very and also knew a lot of people in show business, which a friend of Phil Silvers and Jackie Gleason and. He hung out at this place called Toots Shores, which was a very prominent place. Toots Shore is my Uncle Toots, not by blood, but he was a great family friend who came over to our house a lot. So I think that was actually kind of one of the things that got me very interested early on in
cocaine.
In cocaine. No, booze. Booze, actually.
Tooting.
What's interesting is that there's not one reference in the Bible of a disciple called Toots.
He was the one who was too drunk to show up for the Last Supper, actually.
Get that trick again, Jesus.
Yeah. He said, hey, Jesus, you crumb bum.
Is that Frank's dad won a Pulitzer Prize, and my father owned a bowling alley.
It's a small world.
And he won the Nobel Prize for bowling alleys.
He did.
And my dad, I was always intimidated by his Pulitzer, but then when I was nominated for a Cable Ace Award, it's like, okay, I finally passed you, Dad.
Your dad was a war correspondent in the Pacific Theater, the German Theater.
In a burlesque theater.
In the burlesque theater, yes.
Which theater was he in?
He was in Europe.
What did he see? Did he go?
He saw a lot of action.
I want to know what he did.
Patton around, I think, for a while, and I think he saw some of the concentration camps too when they were being liberated. And his Pulitzer was for interviewing Khrushchev in the mid 1950s. And so he was, just a very active.
You're very respectful. I can tell. It's interesting. A deviant when it comes to comedy. You will go in, but I can tell that you really do respect your father.
The odd thing is, I kind of respect that he didn't spend any time with us because I can see how much more fun his life was. I could see how he wouldn't want to go to New Rochelle and just be a dad at home.
When you don't get no Pulitzers in New Rochelle.
Yeah, right. When he could be at Toots Shores or he could be hanging out with people. He could be traveling and interviewing people,
There are photographs that I've seen of him with Kennedy.
Yeah, he was very good friends with Kennedy. And
did he give you writing tips?
Well, he actually, that's the thing is, I didn't really know my dad that well because when I was very young, he got very sick. He had a stroke. A large part of my childhood was kind of after his career because he had me in his 40s. You know, he had me like relatively late in life.
And, he had me at Pulitzer.
He had me at Jell-O. So he was very infirm for a lot of my childhood. He was confined to a bed, and then he died when I was pretty young too. I was like 13 when he died. So I didn't really know him that well. I didn't really have a lot of experiences with him. He did take me to see Batman at Shea Stadium, Adam West and.
He was at Shea Stadium?
Batman, at the height of Batmania, they did a tour. And,
like a Q&A or something.
No, they did like a whole thing where the Batmobile came out onto the field at Shea Stadium and Batman was there and Burt Ward. And Frank Gorshin as the Riddler did stand-up, actually.
Turns out the Riddler was an impressionist.
He was. Riddle me this, Batman. How can I get on the Sullivan Show again?
At Shea Stadium, there were 50,000 people.
You could fit that many, but it was, you know, it was just that was at the height of Batman's fame. Of
and
the,
was it
the
was there hysteria there for them?
It wasn't like the Beatles, probably.
It was. I think a lot of the hysteria was just the novelty that my dad was doing something with me.
You know, the hysteria when we went to Shea Stadium was how much they charged for a hot dog. That's what really set my dad on fire. Yes.
Now you looked at it financially.
Your dad owned
a bowling alley in Massapequa Park, Long Island.
How did he get into
Massapequa Park, Amityville, Copaig, Lindenhurst, Babylon?
Exactly, you know the line.
The Long Island Railroad.
He's a conductor. Yes.
He owned a bowling alley.
Yeah.
So you must have been swimming in shoes.
Well, first of all, it was 25 miles from our house, and so I only got to go on occasionally, and I would get to take a friend on a Saturday, and it was the best. I mean,
yeah.
we would work behind the shoe counter, and you know, we'd give out lanes and rent shoes, and then we'd get to bowl, and then we'd get to eat lunch and sit in the bar and watch the color TV because we didn't have a color TV at home when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
And then we get to work behind the lunch counter. I mean, it was incredibly fun.
Yeah.
It was incredibly fun.
It's a lot of fun for most kids to go to work with their dad or their mom and see that world and have fun there.
Mm, yeah. Yeah, I remember when I was a kid, my dad taking me, he was being interviewed on the Barry Gray show in New York.
Barry Gray.
And he took me with him there. No one in my family was involved with bowling alleys, although I had an aunt who was very promiscuous and had a league night in her house.
Oh, God.
How's your game? What's your average?
Not good.
What's your average?
You know, maybe I break 100.
Oh, you should be able to do better than that.
David, it was 25 miles from our house.
Do you have your own bowling ball?
She has an even better record of renting shoes.
Right.
I am
very fine. And in fact, I'm wearing a size 8 now if you'd be interested.
When a building goes down, when you hear the sound of things crumbling, does a tear come to your eye and you say, Daddy?
Yes. As a matter of fact, the first house that I ever bought was right behind a bowling alley. And it was actually soothing when I was going to sleep at night, hearing the balls hit the pins. You know, I could hear it was a very faint sound, and it was really nice.
There was a joke in the Woody Allen movie Zelig that he lived, his parents argued, they lived above a bowling alley, and their parents argued so much that the people in the bowling alley would complain about the noise.
I
don't remember that.
You know, I saw the PBS documentary about Woody Allen.
Oh, I loved it.
Loved it. And you know, Zelig, when it came out, for I don't know why, you know, Woody Allen.
You kind of didn't get it or something.
I don't know. I didn't like it. I was, you know.
I saw it the
Well,
day
it was
open,
not like his other movies, really.
And I said, you know, I should rewatch that because the name Zelig has become part of our vocabulary.
Right.
And I started watching it. I go, this is one of the best movies he's ever made.
It was
I watched
his,
it like
one
two
of my
nights.
Favorites of his, absolutely.
Brilliant.
It was a break, though, from his pattern of the neurotic kid from Brooklyn or whatever.
There's a very sweet love story within that movie. It's a romantic comedy in a way.
The scientist
and Zelig character, yeah.
Sweeter than any of his actual marriages.
Yes, right.
Did you see the documentary on him on the PBS?
No, I know that guy. He directs
Whitey.
Larry David.
Yeah, Robert.
Yeah.
Robert
Whitey.
His
yeah.
first documentary is the Marx Brothers, and his production company is called Why a Duck.
Mm-hmm, right.
He's a good guy, and I don't think he's directing Curb anymore, but he did a lot of those in the first few years.
Yeah, he did right. Mort Saul.
Yeah, I saw him interview Albert Brooks at a Writers Guild event. It was he's
very knowledgeable about comedy.
Yeah,
all his life he studied that.
You know, one of my favorite parts of that documentary was that they were showing Woody Allen was talking about how Diane Keaton, whom he calls Keaton, is like one of the funniest people that he knows. And they show the scene in Sleeper when, you know, he's sort of become one of the assimilated into the society
right,
that loves
right.
the leader. And Diane Keaton is now one of the rebels. So they capture Woody Allen and they're trying to break him from his brainwashing. Mm. And the way they do it is they set up a dining room table, and she and the other guy, the other rebel, are holding scripts, and they're making believe that they're Woody Allen's parents. And they're talking in Yiddish to Woody Allen, except Diane Keaton's Yiddish accent is terrible because she doesn't know how to say it. So she goes, "Oy vey, is mir, eat your hot salt water." And, you know, and Woody Allen is like cracking up. Mm-hmm. And I've never seen that. And
I've never seen a Woody Allen blooper before.
I know. It was great. Yeah. And
there's our next sketch. Outtakes from a Woody Allen movie.
And then they show it like they try it like three times. And he can't compose himself. And he goes, okay, let's go on to the next scene. And it was just really interesting to see him going from the actor who's having fun to putting on the director's hat and going, okay, we got to move on.
Right.
You know, we got to get down to business here. And it was really interesting. I loved it.
I think if you guys are like me, you have in the trunk of your car or somewhere in a glove compartment CDs or DVDs you want to listen to, but you don't always get to them.
Mm-hmm.
Recently, for the first time in years and years, I listened to Woody's nightclub act.
Oh, brilliant.
And it's incredibly good. There's a new movie out. I got a screener yesterday. I hadn't heard of it. It's not very well known. It's an independent and no names in it, but it's called In Darkness.
I've heard of that.
Yeah, and it's about a guy who was a sewer worker and also a small-time con man and burglar and shady guy. But he took in a bunch of Jews and let them hide in the sewers of whatever German town it might have been, or maybe Poland.
This place is a cesspool.
Yeah. We haven't read it yet, but we haven't looked at it yet, but my wife and I are kind of interested in seeing
it. And what's it called?
In Darkness.
In Darkness. And is it a German film or an American
film? I can't tell, but I believe it's foreign. Okay. There are a lot of names in there that seem foreign. Mm-hmm. Didn't seem like French or anything. But
you have worked with every director. Have you?
Not every director.
But you've worked with everybody.
I work with you.
Well.
No, I only work with Robert Altman. And
what about Woody Allen?
No.
Did you ever get called in to?
I auditioned a couple of times for him.
But you knew him when he was a stand-up, right? Bills with him?
I didn't. I didn't know him. Mm-hmm. I had a writer who wrote stuff for my stand-up act back in the days when people wrote for stand-up
right,
acts.
Right, which he did, too, in his early career.
And my friend and he had been at this special place up in the Poconos called Tamament, where Saturday night they did an original review.
Mm-hmm.
I was at there's a twin place, a place called Green Mansions in the Adirondacks.
Mm-hmm.
And I was there with Carol Burnett, and our staff lyricist was Sheldon Harnick, who wrote Fiddler. And every week they write a new review, and we do it on a Saturday. So I did meet Woody once to shake hands with him and to visit my friend at Tamament.
In the documentary, they show photos and talk about Tamament.
Tamament was the home of really all the people ended up on your show of shows. Right. Caesar was there,
mm-hmm.
Howie, Imogene.
That was the training ground in those days.
Absolutely.
Right? That's where everybody honed their craft.
And many of the writers.
Went on to big
and every Labor Day, the big agents from New York would come to, on a Saturday, they'd go to Tamament and see the best of for the season. And the next day, they would go up to Green Mansions in upstate New York and see the best of that show. And frequently, the very best of show would end up the next season as a Broadway review with Sid Caesar and people like that.
Wow.
But everybody was there.
Auditioning for Woody Allen, what is that like?
Well, I didn't notice it when I auditioned for him. I kind of wasn't looking in his eyes, really. I'm looking at the reader who's the casting director. But I've heard later that he doesn't want anybody to look at him. Don't look him in the eye when you meet him. You know, so the casting director is reading with you, and whatever he's seeing, he's seeing. But once I met them on the street, and I knew Mia Farrow because I played her father in a movie called Wedding.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I had met Woody to say hello a couple times through my friend. I passed him on 57th Street. And as I passed him, and I said, hi, Mia, how you doing, Woody? And they just, you know.
Right.
I was just like, nobody. Mm-hmm. They just thought another crazed fan, and we can't stop and talk. Mm-hmm. Hardly even looked at me. Mm-hmm. But I spent 8 weeks with Mia Farrow doing that movie.
Wow. Paul, who directed Breaking Away?
His name was Peter Yates. He's an Englishman.
Oh, of course. Right. Yeah.
And the guy who wrote it was born in Yugoslavia until he came to America at 12.
Steve Tesich. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's a brilliant script, and he won the Oscar.
And Peter Yates, by the way, who did a lot of other great movies, including one I recommend, The Friends of Eddie Coyle.
I love that movie.
Yeah.
Right.
And his big hit was Bullet.
Bullet, yeah.
Right.
And he was very versatile. He did a lot of different kinds of movies.
And I learned a little later after I worked with him that before he became involved with movies or the theater, he had been a manager and an agent for racetrack drivers. So he was living in a world of automotive things.
Oh, wow. That's
then he went to the Old Vic or one of those Shakespearean companies, became a stage manager, and went up through the ranks, became a director.
Mm-hmm.
But
I loved that movie.
Whatever he did, that was obviously a wonderful movie. It's a cult movie now.
Yeah. You were in Minnesota.
Yes, we were in Minnesota for a while. And I'm exotic in Minneapolis. You know,
but Minneapolis is my favorite city.
It's a great city.
I lived there for 10 years. It's a great place.
You were picking bugs off your body.
I was.
Well, it's sort of like a Jew in Gentileville or something.
Yes. I mean, it's a very white city. It's a really white city.
They do have a black population.
Very ghettoized city.
It is.
I mean, it's not heterogeneous at all.
No.
The blacks live in North Minneapolis. The Jews live in St. Louis Park or Highland Park or Golden Valley. And we were living in South Minneapolis. I mean, there are so many churches there. It's a land of 10,000 churches.
10,000 drug rehab centers, too, which is how I ended up there.
Yeah, I mean, it's a very progressive city.
Yeah.
It's pretty. The lakes are gorgeous.
And the people are great.
The people are really nice.
There's a great,
very intelligent,
great creative,
very progressive.
Is that where
Tyrone
Guthrie had the theater?
Yeah, that was the very first regional theater, I believe.
Yep. There used to be an improv company related to that somehow.
Oh.
One of the earliest improv companies was around that same theater complex or something. I forget the name of it.
Who was Tyrone Guthrie? I know that the Guthrie Theater.
Well, the Guthrie Theater is.
But who was? I keep thinking of Arlo Guthrie. But who was Tyrone?
It's the same guy. It's just a nickname. Oh. I think he was English. I never met him, but I read about him a lot. And
he was black, right? Tyrone?
Just because he's Tyrone.
And his brother Afro Guthrie.
Anyway, he had a very big reputation for that regional theater. And I think at some point he did some directing on Broadway. But
he was a very well-known theater director of Broadway in London. And
of the regional theaters, it was one of the most respected.
And it still is.
And the audiences in Minneapolis.
Great.
It's heaven.
It's great.
I land every time. I go there once a year, and my shoulders just drop the minute I get there because it's just so relaxed.
Yeah.
The people are kind. I guess it's because of the weather. You look at people in Minneapolis. When my car breaks down on the road, is this person going to help me or kill me? And I think they just put out a vibe. No, I'm the guy who will pull over and help you.
Right.
Right.
But if I see you in a restaurant or something, like, I'll avoid your eyes, and it'll be really awkward if we have any kind of, like, regular conversation, and I'll be very aloof. But if you're in trouble, I will drop everything and help you.
Right. Right. That's very true.
Half of that is like auditioning for Woody Allen.
Right.
The helping part is Now, why were you in Minnesota?
We were fixing our house here.
But you've been fixing that house since I've known you.
Yeah. Well, we're no longer fixing the house.
You've accepted it.
The house is gone. I mean, it's still there, but it's not ours anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And
the house has to want to be fixed.
That's right. The house should have gone to Minneapolis.
Spay and neuter, if you're listening, spay and neuter your home.
It was nice. It was nice. And there's a lot of good comedy there too, and you know, of course, when Frank was there and when Tom, my husband, was there, comedy was great.
I knew your
there.
Husband before you did.
I know.
Back in Minneapolis.
Some of the greatest comics have come out of Minnesota.
Oh yeah,
Louis Anderson came out of there.
Tom Arnold, Jeff Cesario, Frank Conniff.
Yep.
All the guys from Cinematic Titanic.
Liz Winstead.
Joel Hodgson, right?
Yeah.
And then...
Mitch Hedberg, God rest his soul.
That's right. Mary Jo Peel.
Mary Jo Peel, yeah.
Betty Cantor, Fanny Bryce, they all came. What is this Lower East Side? I used to tell people when I went to New York, I was born in the Lower East Side of West Virginia. It's a comic.
Well, before we wrap it up, the new year is upon us, 2012. A year from now, we'll be looking at 2013. What would you like to change? We'll start with Paul.
Maybe my knees will feel better when I climb stairs.
And Frank?
I would like to have said this time next year, wow, 2012 was so much less stressful than 2011. I would love that.
But I think people are discovering, like, or rediscovering you, right?
It's funny. I think that because of the internet, because of Twitter and Facebook, like, I have a presence in the whatever the public, and I use that term loosely, that I didn't have before. And Cinematic Titanic too. But that's like, you know, it's like my old Mystery Science Theater fans. But there, I think now because of Twitter, you know, I do like at least one joke a day on Twitter and Facebook, and I think I've built up a little following from that. And I think there's a whole bunch of people who know me from that more than anything else now. So that's kind of interesting.
Yeah,
The podcasts.
And the podcast.
And the podcast that I'm doing this show, doing Jimmy Dore's show. I mean, creatively, you know, this has been a really great time for me. Mm-hmm. I mean, doing this show has been a real, has been a blessing and a treasure. And doing the other things that I do around L.A. and stuff and on the road have been really great. Yeah.
Your name comes up, Frank. I mean, people are... in awe of your writing. I wanted to ask you two questions. One is, can you write a sketch for next week? The outtakes from a Woody Allen movie? I made a note. That would make me... the other thing is, Have you thought about blogging?
I used to blog on MySpace back in the day. I had a... I had to have a concept for a blog before I could blog, and I had a thing for a while called the Pinkberry blog, and it was all based on... I would go to, like, whether I went to Pinkberry that day or not. And then I would use that as a jumping off point to write about politics or whatever. Mm-hmm. But I did that for like several months, the Pinkberry blog.
But I spent 2011 trying to figure out what blog meant. Just for a moment, let me tell you a great Gelbart line. When Larry Gelbart passed away, they quoted some of his lines in his obituary. One of them talked about age. He said, "The first thing to go are not your knees. It's the word for knees."
Oh, what a great line.
That's great.
He was.
He also, I heard someone said, maybe Paul, you might have even told me this, so I'm sorry to be, said, someone said, Milton Berle was at the Paramount. Yes, but his cock was at the Palace.
What would you like for 2012?
You're not going to want it to be on your show, what I have to say.
Well, is
it's
it negative?
Too maudlin.
Is it negative?
It's not negative. It's just kind of serious.
Oh, go ahead.
I just would like to be able to be happy and accept myself. It's not funny.
It's not
I
funny.
Don't think that's in the cards.
That's not in the cards. Why accept yourself?
Yeah.
Maybe this program will help.
But you're a comedian.
You mean you don't think it's possible?
I think, why would we accept ourselves?
You might lose your funny.
I don't know. You know, I don't know if that's true. That
I think, Frank, do you accept yourself?
Not really. But but I also think that talent is talent and devotion to talent is devotion to talent. So in other words, like, I think the idea that if you had a crummy childhood or if you're an unhappy person, that it's it can be helpful to your art. But if you're a happy person, and I'm talking purely hypothetically in the realm of fantasy here, but if you are a happy person, I think your talent can still be applied and you can still do great work. You know, I think it's a bit of a myth that you have to suffer for your art in terms of poverty, and, you know, poverty is the worst thing in the world for your art, because all you're thinking about is money all the time. You're just worried about money. You can't concentrate on what you want to write or what you want to do. So the idea, that's a complete myth, I think. And I think it's also the idea that you have to be unhappy for the rest of your life to be creative is I don't think is necessarily true.
I mean, I don't want to have to cut off my ear. Yeah. Although I hate my ears, to tell you the truth, I'd like to cut off both of my ears.
Self-loathing leers.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Great, Cathy. Thank you,
David.
Thank you.